This is the true story of Murder One. In 1995, ABC Television premiered a new legal show called Murder One, which starred Daniel Benzali as the lead defense attorney, Teddy Hoffman, in a show created by Stephen Boschow, who created Hill Street Blues, St. Elsewhere, NYPD Blue, but also Cop Rock.
Hey, let's be careful out there. Let's be careful out there.
Murder One is my number 34 ranked favorite show of all time, which is pretty impressive considering it had a limited 2-year run. Murder One was given the coveted 10 p.m. Thursday night spot. ABC, in fact, lined up a night of 3 straight new drama shows for the 95-96 season: Charlie Grace, The Monroes, and then Murder One. It was going up against NBC's juggernaut must-see TV, which included that year Friends and Seinfeld, and matched Murder One directly up against ER in the week's most prestigious time slot. Sure seems to me like Murder One would have been a great Sunday night show instead. Over at CBS, they had the geriatric eyeballs locked up with Murder, She Wrote and 48 Hours. With Fox going after a younger generation, it seemed like ABC was walking a tightrope, trying to draw some viewers from CBS, but also trying to appeal to a younger audience at the same time. The season before, on Thursday night, ABC had put in 2 rookie shows, My So-Called Life and McKenna, and a Murder One's 10 p.m. slot was the news program Primetime Live, which actually did an 11.7 and finished tied for number 29 in primetime. Not bad at all. But ABC moved Primetime Live to Wednesday night at 10 p.m. up against Law & Order and away from ER, leaving the spot open for poor Murder One. Someone has to wonder what would have happened if Murder One had been placed on Wednesday night instead against Law & Order, which was already losing ground by this time. ER was the top-rated show of the year, finishing with a 22.0 rating, while Murder One finished 66th with an 8.9 rating. It fared much better than Charlie Grace, which did a 6.6 for 108th, while The Monroes was even worse at 5.6 for 126th spot. Both those shows were canceled. The thing that made Murder One different was that while other legal and cop shows were episodic or procedural in nature, this show was a serial. What that meant was that there would be one long, detailed murder case that would have its twists and turns play out throughout the entire season, instead of the stories wrapping up at the end of each episode. While this is old hat now, and had been done before, it was fairly unique to that genre in 1995. To give you an idea, drama shows that aired on ABC the season before were Lois and Clark, The New Adventures of Superman, NYPD Blue, My So-Called Life, Matlock, McKenna, and The Marshal. ABC was still very sitcom heavy, had a couple primetime news programs, and still had a movie of the week. In addition to Murder One, ABC introduced Charlie Grace, High Incident, The Monroes, which was a primetime soap, and Second Noah as new drama shows that season. High Incident was a procedural cop show in the NYPD Blue mode, and was actually a show that I really enjoyed during its 2-year run. It was from DreamWorks, and its creative team included Steven Spielberg. So you can see Murder One's format and seriousness really set it apart. Dramas on the other networks included, over at CBS, Chicago Hope, Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, Murder, She Wrote, and Walker, Texas Ranger. Over at Fox, they had America's Most Wanted, Beverly Hills 90210, Party of Five, and X-Files. NBC, in the meantime, was running fantastic episodic dramas in ER, Homicide, Life on the Street, and Law & Order. NBC also premiered JAG in 1995. Again, as you can see, Murder One really stood out in tone and being serial. The show itself was incredible. The pilot episode called Chapter One, each episode just followed that simple nomenclature. That episode was ranked in 1997 by TV Guide as number 60 on its list of top 100 greatest episodes in television history. Season One may very well be my favorite season of TV ever. The first season revolved around the murder of 15-year-old Jessica Costello. Stanley Tucci played Richard Cross, a love-struck philanthropist who is mercurial at best, evil at worst. He was the first suspect and was arrested since he was dating Jessica's sister, Julie. The death of Jessica was horrific as she was found raped, tied up, and strangled in her apartment. After Cross was released, the next suspect arrested was Neil Avedon, a young Hollywood heartthrob who had used Teddy Hoffman in the past for various minor offenses. Although Teddy had fired Avedon as a client in episode one, when he was later charged with murder, Teddy agreed to take the case. The rest of the season revolved around Teddy and his band of young associates defending Avedon and using his private detectives, David Blaylock, to investigate the murder. Jessica's sister Julie turned against her boyfriend Richard Cross, now believing he was the murderer, and testified about how Richard and a slimy character named Dr. Lester would drug and rape her and other patients. Stanley Tucci was outstanding as Cross, and Kevin Teague was spot on as Davey Blaylock. But other than Teddy, the best played character was Jason Gedrick as the young Neil Avedon. He nailed every scene he was in, bordering on overacting, but never quite getting there. I remember thinking at the time that he was going to become a really big star. Apparently, I was wrong. Neil Avedon is remorseful, but was too high the night in question to even remember if he did the deed or not. And quite frankly, Teddy is only interested in acquitting his client, not in the truth that Avedon is seeking for his own peace of mind. In addition to the murder case, there are minor cases introduced from episode to episode, which helps develop the other characters in the show as well as provide a bit of variety. Associates included Mary McCormick, Michael Hayden, and J.C. McKenzie, who was an openly gay receptionist, played fantastic by J.C. McKenzie, not as a caricature or stereotype. While there's certainly moments of levity in Murder One, for the most part, it is a cerebral, slow-paced, dark show. The boardrooms and offices of the defense are luxurious and dark, while the DA offices are industrial lit and cheap. Teddy Hoffman is urbane and sophisticated, while the lead DA, Miriam Grasso, hides her talents behind a Columbo-like exterior facade. I'm not going to tell you how the murder trial wound up, but there were a couple of big surprises and U-turns at the end. However, before we go on talking briefly about season two, we need to discuss why this show and ultimately season one failed. Many of these are just my own theories and conjecture. First of all, the serial nature of the show was fairly new for this genre and may have caught casual viewers by surprise. In fact, within a few years, this type of show would become a major trend with shows like 24, Prison Break, Vanished, Jericho, Lost, and many more that I'm probably forgetting. The fact that most homes only had VCRs at this time and repeats could not be found easily, it required a level of commitment that you just don't need anymore. To combat that commitment level, the show began to lead off with a very detailed previously on Murder One segment, much longer than other dramas shows used, and this was to catch viewers up. However, sometimes it's just not easy being a pioneer. Secondly, the time slot was a killer. As mentioned, they were up against the number one show on TV, ER, and had two rookie shows as lead-ins, which would both be canceled. Yeah, back then, lead-ins certainly mattered more than they do today. Thirdly, the main character, Teddy Hoffman, did not resonate well with viewers. He was too sophisticated and deliberate. Viewers were used to shoot from the hips, back-alley brawlers who were determined to get justice for their wrongfully accused clients. Teddy was just doing his job of trying to get his client acquitted and came off as being slimy compared to the overworked DA office. Teddy Hoffman was a country mile away from Ben Matlock. While this type of anti-hero or shades of gray is commonplace today, back then it was not well received in the simplistic world of network television. The fourth reason the show may not have picked up steam, and this is just a theory of mine, is that it was a victim of circumstances of timing. On January 24th, 1995, the trial began of O.J. Simpson, and the amount of coverage as well as the type of live coverage was overwhelming and unprecedented. On October 3rd of 1995, the dream team of lawyers, including Johnny Cochran and Robert Kardashian, managed to get themselves an O.J. and not guilty finding that, quite frankly, did not sit well with many Americans, and specifically with the target audience for ABC and CBS. While episodes 1 and 2 of Murder One had already aired, This OJ verdict delivery was the same day as episode 3. The time was not right to have Americans tune in to a show about morally ambiguous and glamorous defense attorneys getting their celebrities off for crimes they may very well have committed. Season 2. I suppose that there was enough faith in the show and its format to renew it for a second season. Given its ratings were not terrible, considering the competition it faced, I can see why that decision was made. However, they did decide to take the show in a different direction by parting ways with Daniel Benzali. More in the poop on that in a bit, and you don't want to miss this. But they replaced his character Teddy Hoffman with Jimmy Wyler, played by Vinny LaPaglia, best known as the lead in Without a Trace. Jimmy Wyler was a scorned ADA who decided to go private after being denied a promotion. The whole tone of the show changed, going away from the sophisticated Hoffman to the brawler Wyler, a character more likable to the audience, I suppose, though not to me. The format also changed to having cases that ran multiple episodes, some overlapping, but none running the full season. ADA Miriam Grasso was back on the other side of the aisle. To make the circle even smaller, the first murder case revolves around the killing of a candidate running for governor who is running against Jimmy Wyler's boss, the former DA, who denied him his promotion to prosecute major crimes. So Jimmy seeks to defend the accused and basically buys his way into Hoffman and Associates as Teddy has left the firm to try and salvage his marriage and his life. The firm is on life support, and unlike last season, Wyler is spending a great deal of time just trying to keep the firm viable. This adds to the back alley brawler type of firm to fit his personality as opposed to last season's personality of privilege and prestige. Jimmy, though, comes out firing, using his inside information on former cases and procedures to try and discredit witnesses and experts to get his client acquitted, making him very unpopular with the government. The case of the governor started in episode 1 and finished in episode 8. Another story which seemed to echo in the same ways the O.J. Simpson case ironically did was a basketball star, Ricky Luttrell, is accused of murdering the team's owner. So while the governor arc ran episodes 1 to 8, Luttrell ran episodes 4 to 12. So there was overlap. A third case then begins with episode 13 and runs through the end of the year, which was episode 18. I would have to wonder if the plan here was to wrap up the first two cases at the end of episode 12 in case it was not renewed for a back half of the season. In fact, episodes 11 and 12 aired on January 23rd, 1997 to wrap up the Luttrell case. The show then returned for an additional 6 episodes airing in rapid succession with 2 episodes a night on May 25th, 26th, and 29th. By now the show had been canceled. Would sure seem that they were just burning off episodes. Personally, I remember these last 6 episodes being advertised as a Murder 1 miniseries and were certainly presented that way. The accused was played by the unforgettable Pruitt Taylor Vince, who suffered from nystagmus, an involuntary movement of the eyes which caused him to constantly shake. Because of his size and this nystagmus, Vince is usually cast as a psychotic murderer or a simple country bumpkin, who is usually a psychotic murderer. Season 2 saw Murder 1 move out of the 10 p.m. Thursday slot, which was given to a news program, Turning Point, and Murder 1 went into the 9 p.m. slot. Incidentally, it was preceded at 8 p.m. by High Incident, so chances are I was one of the few people watching ABC on Thursday nights instead of the must-see TV of NBC. But in case you thought that would make it easier for Murder 1 by getting away from ER, which would again finish as the number one show on TV. Instead, Murder 1 faced Seinfeld, which finished as the number 2 show, and suddenly Susan, which rode on Seinfeld's coattails, all the way to the number 3 spot. Murder 1's ratings tanked, going from an 8.9 rating in Season 1 to 5.7 rating in Season 2, a 35% drop, and went from 66th overall to 113th overall. Both Murder 1 and High Incident were canceled and did not return for a third season. There were so many good actors in the show, including Dylan Baker, Vanessa Williams, Patricia Clarkson, D.B. Woodside, Gregory Itzen, John Plachette, Neil McDonough, Tia Carrera, and Titus Welliver, just to name a few. Now, onto the straight poop I promised you. So I remember back in the day, assuming that Benzali was replaced in the lead for the reasons that I mentioned earlier. He didn't relate to the audience, was too out of the box for network television. Well, I didn't agree with the move. I at least understood it. Now, I'm sure that the ratings had something to do with it, and the fact that Stephen Wilshire really had so many irons in the fire that he didn't care if one burnt out. However, in an interview in 2016 on the Rich Eisen show, Wilshire revealed another reason why he parted ways with Benzali after the season was over. It seems that Benzali was an hour late every day to the set due to the drive-in from his Malibu home. Now, Wilshire tried his best to reason with Benzali to keep his job, leave an hour earlier, or rent you an apartment close to set during the week. But Benzali would have none of it. You see, not only did he love living in Malibu, but it was the only place he felt comfortable going to the bathroom, specifically his morning number two. Yeah, that's right. Wilshire claims that Benzali lost his job because he refused to alter his morning constitutional routine.
That is unbelievable. What do you think of that, Brockman? Would you ever lose a job over the fact that you've got to go in your home spot?
Well, I will say this.
Yes.
I can go number two anywhere.
No, I'm willing to bet that one side or the other would have made it work if the show looked to be a success. However, with the writing on the wall, neither one seemed to want the headache, so the change was made. Oh, the things you would never have discovered if not for the internet. So that is the somewhat complete story of one of the best TV shows of all time, Murder One, which only got a 2-year run due to being too far ahead of its time, some bad timing with the effects of the O.J. Simpson acquittal, some really stiff competition with ER, and then Seinfeld, and finally because Benzali would only poop at home. It's not easy to find Murder One. I did have the season one on DVD, but I made the mistake of lending it to a relative who soon forgot that I loaned it to them and sold it in a garage sale. So if you watched Murder One from DVDs you bought in a garage sale, you're very welcome. If not, if you can find it, check it out. It is a fantastic show. Thanks for watching.